आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट एरिया ऑफ टूडेज लेसन. यू कैन एक्सपेक्ट अ क्वेश्चन इन द फाइनल एग्जाम फ्रॉम दिस एरिया, सो यू हैव टू बी वेरी वेरी क्लियरली अंडरस्टैंडिंग द कॉन्सेप्ट्स व्हाट आई एम गोइंग टू एक्सप्लेन नाउ. As in the morning, I discuss with you, it's up to the management to decide whether they are going for safety precautions or not. Most of the management, if you see, they are focusing more on making profit. Their main focus or their main objective is to maximize the profit, minimize expenditures. Their safety, most of them compromise. Because there is one area you can compromise, because nobody thinks about safety until an accident strikes. Everybody discusses about safety only after the accident strikes. This is a common tendency of people. You can think how many people use helmet while they are riding a bike voluntarily. Very few people, if you see, they are actually putting the seat belt when they are inside the car. Majority of the people, they don't do it. Why? Because it restricts the freedom. They are a little bit uncomfortable, but they don't know the value of that. But if they really know the value of using a helmet, if they know the value of using a seatbelt, they will voluntarily do it without anybody noticing it. The same thing. The main problem, employers, lack of awareness of the importance of safety. They are lacking awareness. So we are safety professionals. We must be confident of explaining to the management why they should support safety in the workplace more than anything else. Your production, process, profit, marketing, everything comes after safety. Safety should be the highest priority for any organization, because once safety is taken care of, discipline will come. Once discipline is there, accidents will reduce. Once accidents reduce, automatically your cost will reduce and profit will increase. So the employer's thought process should be achieving maximum benefit through safety, not by bypassing safety. If they bypass safety and achieve the profit, it is momentary. One day they will pay the price, and that will be the last day. They will not be there to even enjoy the fruit of this 20 years, 30 years, 50 years of their toil. So the first thing every employer in the organization should be clear is, providing safety to employees is a moral requirement. It is a moral responsibility of every employer. Employees are also human beings. Each human being's, their life is precious. A worker may be a worker coming to work, but behind that worker, there is a family completely depending on this employee. There will be parents depending on the employee. There will be relatives, friends, wife or husband, children, depending on this one individual. If that individual is going to be killed at workplace, then the whole family is going to suffer throughout their life. Just imagine that fate of the children, how they are going to grow up. So every employer should understand, these employees are coming to work for you. These employees are coming to work because they need money to feed their family. Out of compulsion, they are coming. And you should not trap them. You should not make them sick. You should not kill them. Every employer should know that. It is an unwritten law that employers are ultimately, because it's your property, it's the employer's money, employer's premise, employer's property, and you have to provide safety to the employees. It is the moral responsibility. Like when we were children, we were born, we were vulnerable to diseases, but our parents, they took great care of us when we were young, nurtured us, took to the doctors, gave us the medicines, grown up, you know, we all grown up. And when we are grown up, we have to pay back. We have to look after them. That is our moral responsibility, maybe directly or indirectly. We have to give back to our parents what they gave to us when we were young. It's a moral responsibility of every individual. That when they become old, we have to give the same care what they gave to us when we were babies or young. It's a moral responsibility. Same moral responsibility every employer has towards the employees. It's very clear. Now, there are many employers who understand this and they do it. Voluntarily, they say, my first priority is safety of my employees. For me, everything else is secondary. Because human life, you cannot replace it. You cannot compensate it. It's invaluable. So they give highest priority to life and safety. But there are few employees who disregard. Oh, these are workers, poor people. Leave them. I want to maximize my profit. That's, if that is the case, then there is a law coming inside. So the world over, the governments of every country has framed act, rules, regulations to control such employers because they have legal framework. Every country has a legal framework. Why? Because it is an ILO requirement. International Labor Organization has very clearly and specifically stated every member countries must have legal framework to control occupational health and safety in their country. India is a member of United Nations. That means we are indirectly member of ILO. Qatar is a member of United Nations. Automatically, it becomes member of ILO. Oman is a member of UN. Any country for that matter. I will be covering that later. So the International Labour Organization very clearly says that every government should have a labor act to catch these kind of employers who are not morally responsible. So definitely comes like in India, we had Factories Act, BOCW Act. Now we have Code of Occupational Health and Safety 2020, under which any employer employing 10 or more employees must have safety policy, must have safety systems. If they don't do it, then prosecution will be there, enforcement action will be taken. So there is a law very clearly states, and they do it. So all those employers who are not morally obliged, there is a legal provision now. They can be imprisoned. The directors can be imprisoned if they don't follow the safety procedures. Enforcement action will be taken. The same thing happened taking care of the parents. Some of the children were not ready to take care of the parents. So the government has brought an act now. If the parents are not taken care, and if they complain to the government, the children will be put inside the jail. Very clear. And all the assets inherited should go back to the parents. Very clear law for the erring people. So if somebody is not morally responsible, then they will be forced to do it legally. And if they violate, they will get prosecuted and punished by the government. That is the legal requirement. And finally, the employer should know that your organization may be 75-year-old organization. Your organization may be 100-year-old organization, but one accident can finish the entire organization, and that one accident, your life will be gone. The directors will be jailed. Whatever you earned in the last 75 years will be nothing because of one single accident. This is what I was explaining to you in the morning. And if you have seen my video, Introduction to Safety Management, I am very clearly explaining what happened in the Bhopal gas tragedy. That big and mighty organization called Union Carbide, a global conglomerate, collapsed to ashes because of that one single accident which happened in Bhopal. Because there is direct cost. After every accident, there are majorly two costs. We call it direct cost and indirect cost. The measurable cost, non-measurable cost. It's mostly the indirect cost which kill the business, because it is irrecoverable. So due to these three reasons, whether it is a moral reason, whether it is a legal reason, or it's a financial reason, every employer must keep safety as the first priority in the organization if you want to sustain, if you want to survive. So please understand that. Now I'll give you the points for this. The primary reason to manage health and safety in any organization is the moral reason. Employers owe a duty of care to every worker, because employer is the holder of the organization. He is the ultimate person who is to decide on safety measures. Society expects employers to conduct their business in a safe way. If there is tomorrow a gas leak and you are going to kill the public, public will not leave you. Even the society expect from every organization, society expect prosperity. Suppose there is a village and you are setting a chemical plant in a village. The villagers expect that you will give job opportunities, you will give roads, schools, good living conditions, you will bring prosperity to them. But you are bringing methyl isocyanate gas and you are leaking that gas and killing all this public. That is, they never expect it. They never expect. Employers have a moral duty to protect health and safety of workers, visitors, contractors, and even the public. They have a moral reason to protect the safety of these people. When a worker is killed, injured, or suffer any terrible disease by any accident, he is not the only one to suffer, but also his family, dependents, friends, and colleagues pass through a massive impact. Correct? It is morally unacceptable to expose the worker to danger to the work that they do.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah?
Can you explain one more when a worker is killed?
Yeah, when a worker is killed, injured, or suffer any terrible disease by any accident, he is not the only person to suffer, correct? See, if an employee, if a worker is the head of the family, and if he is killed in an accident, the whole family will suffer, correct? Correct or not?
Yeah, the whole family will be suffering because of the loss.
That is the one person who was earning it. Maybe the company will give some compensation, but how long it will sustain?
Yeah, but it's not sufficient for a family. So
that is what, it has a massive impact. Even it affects the friends of that person, relatives. It is morally unacceptable to expose the worker to danger in return to the work that they do. Just because they are coming to work, you cannot expose them to risk and create accident where they are going to suffer. It is the moral duty of the employer to prevent his workers from pain and suffering, from injuries and ill health, by providing them a safe working environment. These three bullet points, all of you, quickly note down, please. I'm giving you one. So you got a clear idea what are the moral reasons why employer should maintain safety in a workplace. Now let us go to the legal reasons. Legal reasons means, as I said, every country has got a legal framework to protect the employees. Like India, we have the Code of Occupational Health and Safety 2020. Every country. And everybody working in any country, you should know what is your country's act. There can be Labor Act. There can be Workplace Safety Act. Every country will have an act which clearly says employers are ultimate responsible for providing safety to employees. Employer must follow these legal requirements. Otherwise, what will happen? They will go to prosecution. As per the law, employer must provide a safe place of work, safe systems, safe procedures to avoid accidents and illness. If they don't provide, and if there is an accident, definitely they are going to jail. That is sure. Many employers don't know this. Okay, they think safety department will be responsible. No. Safety department is coming under staff department. The line department is always responsible for safety. Line department means production manager, the project managers who take decisions. Our role is always advisory. We can only say do like that, do like this. Whether to do it or not, they are the people taking decisions. So always understand this. Safety is a staff function, like HR, accounts, admin. We are all doing advisory service. We are not producing anything. But production manager, marketing, production, they all come under the line function. Those are the people taking decisions. Moral reason, legal reason, complete. All these points you remember, one question you can expect from this area. The last one is the financial reason. As I told you, whenever there is an accident, there will be huge cost in the form of direct cost and indirect cost. So poor safety standards or performance can lead to accidents, and accidents will result in huge cost in the form of direct and indirect cost. The financial loss from accident can even lead to closure of the business. Finished. Whatever you earned in the last 50 years, 60 years, it will become zero because of one accident. An effective safety management system can reduce the cost of accidents. So we need to know a little deeper into what are the direct costs. And these are all in the textbook, so you need not to worry. So let us see the financial arguments to justify health and safety improvements. This you can note down. Please note down this. Financial arguments to justify health and safety improvements. What arguments will you place before your management to enable them to support you? So you have to tell, good health and safety systems can improve the reputation of the organization. When you are ISO certified company 45001, your reputation will be high because accidents are less. Bring future business. Even if clients looking for contractors, they check whether you have a very good health and safety management system, because when you are a contractor, you are taking contract with a client. Even if your system fails, the client will be responsible. It will reduce insurance premiums. You know, every year you are paying for insurance, the insurance people, they come to audit. If they find that health and safety management system is good, the premium will reduce. If they find it is poor, the premium will be increasing year by year. That way you are going to lose. Improve workers' morale and increase productivity. When you give good safety management system, good welfare facility, the workers' morale will be high. Morale means motivation. It can avoid court fines and compensation, unnecessary court fine, compensation payment. All this can be avoided if you have a good safety management system, reducing accidents. Keep employees healthy and happy. Increasing ownership. They will feel that this organization belongs to them, and they work in such a way, not just as employees, but they feel they are part of this organization. So they will not do any mistake and they will support all the safety procedures. So these are the general financial arguments along with the previous slide. The previous slide is already in the textbook. This is what is added a little bit more. I added to this. So if you write all this, the financial arguments, you have to just slightly explain this, it will be accepted. So what we say, direct cost. Direct cost are measurable cost. Like an equipment. You purchase an equipment, 50 lakh rupees. You have a bill for that. Now, if you have a bill for an equipment, that equipment's cost is measurable. Tomorrow, if there is a fire and this machine is burned, you can tell I lost 50 lakh rupees because there is a bill. And you can get insurance cover. If you have a bill for any equipment, you can go for insurance for that equipment because it is a measurable cost, calculable, like compensation paid to victims. If there is a death, how much money to be paid? In some act, it is written already. Sick pay to be given to the employees. When the employees are admitted in hospital, you cannot cut their fees because it is because of accident. You have to pay. Increase in insurance premium because of accident. If there is accident, the premium will go high. Court fine. It is also direct because it is already mentioned for this offense, this is the fine. It is already mentioned in the act. That is why it is direct. Damage to buildings, equipment, vehicles, all these costs you are seeing here except court fine and premium, the others are insurable. But court fine, you cannot get insurance. Premium, you cannot get insurance, but other things you can get insurance. So these are measurable cost. You can calculate what is the loss, but there are so many other losses you cannot calculate. You don't get a bill. Future business loss. Today, yeah.
Can you explain once more what was the insurance? What we won't get the insurance pre, like
you. Yeah. Mentioned. See. Yeah, I got your point. See, compensation to be paid to victims, you can insure all your employees. Worker sick pay also, you can get through insurance if you have a specific coverage. But increase in premium, you cannot get insurance for this. Court fine, you cannot insure. But equipment, you can insure. Vehicles, you can insure. Building, you can insure.
Yeah, okay, fine, fine. I got the point. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Now coming to here, nothing is insurable here. Here, nothing. You in indirect cost, the problem with indirect cost is none of this is insurable. You will not get insurance cover. Future business loss. You never know how much business is going to come in future. Hiring and training of new staff, because you already lost some staff. Production delay and your orders get canceled because of the accident. Every media will cover your organization name. Your reputation and goodwill will be lost. Overtime payment for covering the loss. Because you already lost some employees, your order is pending, you will put other people on overtime. Man hours lost due to investigation. All these are called indirect because they are not calculable. You cannot put a fixed scale for this. And all this together, and there are so many in the textbook, if you see, in the internet, you can see what are the direct cost and indirect cost. So if you compare, it is like this. It is like an iceberg. The direct cost forms only a small portion, but if you see the indirect cost, they are the majority. If direct cost is 1 crore, suppose 1 crore, indirect will be around 36 crores. So here, out of this 1 crore, at least 50 lakhs, you will get insurance claim. You can claim, but here nothing you can claim. And that is why if employers think that I have insurance, they are only looking at this direct cost. They never know that there is a big portion. This is like iceberg. We say iceberg theory, the Titanic ship. sank because of hitting this big part, which nobody realized. See? So this is why whenever there is an accident, the whole organization will collapse to zero, because the indirect cost, which is huge amount of indirect cost, will kill the business. And that's the end of the organization. This is what happened to Union Carbide. If you still have not seen that video, please, all of you, I'm telling, Introduction to Safety Management, available in the YouTube, you must see that. Here I am explaining clearly what happened in Bhopal. You will understand it. Any questions till now? So we have covered moral reason, social reason, economic reason, why an organization is better to invest in safety than to face accidents. If you have any doubt till here, preventive reasons to avoid from enforcement notices, because if the employer, is not following the legal requirement, the legal department or the enforcement department will give them notice, improvement notice or prohibition notice. So these are called preventive reasons. When there is an inspection by civil defense mechanism, like in India, the labor officers, the factory inspectors, they go to factory. They have a target, like every month you have to visit 10 factories or 20 factories and give a report to the government. So if they find safety violation, they will give improvement notice. They will give prohibition notice. They may stop the work. These are called preventive reasons. Legally, they do it. Then there is another reason called punitive damage. Punitive means punishment. They can give fine. Where the criminal prosecution due to breaches of legal duty may result in a fine for the organization. They will create fine, 1 lakh rupees fine, because you don't have safety measures here. You don't have fire sprinkler systems. You don't have any fire safety measures. Okay, 1 lakh rupees fine. Or imprisonment, if there is a death due to an accident, the directors may go to jail. Or they may give both. They will put fine also and they will send to jail also. So that is called punitive measures. Then compensatory. Compensatory means when employees are affected. Yeah.
Can you explain once more punitive damage?
Punitive damage, see, preventive reason means to prevent future accidents. I am a labor inspector. I visited a factory. I found that there are no proper safety arrangements. So I am giving them a notice. I'm telling, I will come back in 6 months and I want you to install all these safety measures. This is called a preventive action. Correct?
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Now what is punitive? I find there is already an accident and one person already killed. Or there is already an accident, somebody's hand is chopped off. Or there is already very serious breaches. So I am fining the employer 1 lakh rupees fine. You do the improvement also and you pay the fine also. Then only you will not repeat it next time.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
This is actually punishing them.
Okay.
Preventive is not punishing, just giving a notice to improve. But punishment is because the violation is so high, I am punishing them. Compensatory, already some claim has come. One worker is killed and the family has claimed 2 crore rupees. Now the court will decide how much compensation to give. They are claiming 2 crore. Company will say, I will give 10 lakhs. But court will finally see the age of the person, qualification, family status. So many things the court will see, say how long he would have lived, how long he could have earned. Very, very good calculations are there, and based on that, they set the compensation. Suppose a worker, for him, the compensation will be different. For an engineer or a manager, the compensation will be different. That depends on the status, depends on the education qualification, life expectancy, family status, everything. So the court will decide that. Age, all these things, then they would have, okay, 1 crore. So company will say 10 lakh, but court will say you have to give 1 crore. That is the compensatory effect. So this you cannot down.